Hello friends, welcome to Ted Russ Ministries for February 25th, 2024, the second Sunday of Lent. We begin this service in the powerful name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our first song is Gather Us In. Is streaming now is the darkness vanished away. See in this space our fears and our dreamings brought here to you in the light of this day. Gather us in the lost and forsaken, gather us in the blind and the lame. To us now, and we shall awaken, we shall arise at the sound of our name. We are the young, our lives are a mystery, we are the old who yearn for your face. We have been sung throughout all of history, called to be light to the whole human race. Gather us in, the rich and the haughty, gather us in, the proud and the strong. Give us a heart so meek and so lowly, give us the courage to enter the song. Bible lesson for today is from Romans chapter 4. The promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be their heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of us all, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist, hoping against hope, Abraham believed he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said, so numerous shall your descendants be. Abraham did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of his wife Sarah's womb. No distrust made Abraham waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, Abraham's faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words, it was reckoned to him, were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in God, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses and was raised for our justification. Here ends a reading from Romans 4, 13 to 25. Our next song is The Old Rugged Cross. One time in one of my parishes in Ohio, somebody was complaining about singing so many new hymns, and they said, whatever happened to the old rugged cross? Well, nothing happened to it. We're going to sing it right now. Cross the emblem of suffering and shame. And we look to the cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So we look to the old rugged cross, till our trophies at last we lay down. We will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. The cross we will ever be true, his shame and reproach gladly bear. God will call us someday to our home far away, where God's glory forever will share. So we look to the old rugged cross, our trophies at last we lay down. We will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
One more time.
So we'll look to the old rugged cross till our trophies at last we lay down. We'll cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. The preacher's sermon was "Forgive Your Enemies." Toward the end of the service, she asked her congregation, "How many of you have really forgiven your enemies?" About half of their hands went up. Then the pastor repeated her question as it was past lunchtime, getting late. This time, about 80% of the congregations held up their hand. She then repeated her question again. Everyone put up their hand except one small elderly lady. "Mrs. Jones," inquired the pastor, "are you not willing to forgive your enemies?" "I don't have any," she replied, smiling sweetly. "Mrs. Jones, that's very unusual. How old are you, Mrs. Jones?"
93 years old," she replied.
"Oh, canal, Mrs. Jones. What a blessing and what an example you are. More of us should follow your example. Would you please come down to the front of the sanctuary and tell the rest of the congregation how a person can live 93 years and not have an enemy in the world?" So the little sweetheart of a lady tottered down the aisle, faced the congregation, and she said proudly, "I outlive the old hags." Our second Bible reading for the second Sunday in Lent is from Romans 4, 13 to 25. Here Paul presents Abraham as the example for how a person comes into a right relationship with God, not through works of the law, but through faith. Though both Abraham and Sarah were far too old for bearing children, Abraham trusted that God would accomplish what God had promised to accomplish. Both Abraham and Sarah are good examples for us today. Abraham's faithfulness was centered in his willingness to trust God for the parts of God's promise to him that he could not control, and to focus on the parts of the covenant that he had power over through his faithful obedience. This process of discernment is also important for you and me. This discernment is a crucial part of faithfulness, but is something we often struggle with in our culture that encourages us to control other people's actions and choices while refusing to accept full responsibility for our own. The Serenity Prayer, often used by Alcoholics Anonymous and other recovery groups, would be useful for some of us, illustrating that discernment and balance are necessary within the covenant God has made
with each one of us. I asked a young man one time why he was willing to stand so long in line to purchase a lottery ticket at one of our stop-and-go stores. His answer stunned me. I buy these tickets because they give me hope. The Bible and Paul, of course, point us to a more lasting source of hope. Hope for Paul comes from God's love that has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. God doesn't just drip a little love into our hearts. God pours his love into our hearts. When we draw closer to the cross this time of year, in faith during Lent, we give God the chance to fill us even more as he speaks to us through his word, his spirit, and the example of others. Hazel Setzer is one of these positive examples. She's a longtime member of the church I'm serving right now, St. Mark's Lutheran Church in Claremont, North Carolina, not far from Hickory. Hazel Setzer gets up in the morning and spends most of the day at her sewing machine preparing colorful and beautiful handmade dresses and outfits for children in poor areas of Africa. When I asked her how many of these she's made, I found out she had made over 5,000 dresses and outfits that children in Africa and other poor places are wearing right now. She is 97 years old and has no plans on stopping this incredible ministry. Last Sunday, I visited with her and her daughter, Kathy, and son-in-law, Roger. They showed me pictures of many happy children in the poorest areas of Africa who were wearing Hazel dresses, and you could tell they were so thankful to receive them. The dresses Hazel makes are colorful and beautiful, of high quality, and yet another example of how to share God's love and kindness with others. Don't you agree? What an inspiration 97-year-old Hazel Setzer is. In the heart of the American Civil War, one of President Lincoln's advisors said he was so thankful that God was on the side of the Union. But Abraham Lincoln replied, "Sir, my concern is not whether God is on our side. My greatest concern is to be on God's side, for God is always right." Today's gospel reading from Mark chapter 8, we find Peter confessing his belief that Jesus is the long-expected Messiah, but then Jesus tells his disciples for the first time what's going to happen soon. Jesus says in Mark 8:31 that he must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed. And Jesus says after 3 days, he will rise again. My friends, we are now in the penitential season we call Lent. The cross of Jesus, of course, looms large during the season of Lent. Yes, we celebrated Christ's birth for 12 full days and then celebrated Epiphany, revealing, the word means revealing, the revealing of Christ to Gentiles. We celebrated that for many weeks, but now we come to the 40 days of Lent. During this time, we enter a season of self-examination and contemplation on the Lord's life, suffering, and death on the cross. The Bible readings and hymns of Lent challenge us to cleanse our hearts and prepare with joy for Easter and God's promise of new life. Lent is a great time to pray and repent and improve our relationships with God and others, do kind things, and try to reflect upon Christ's innocent suffering and death on the cross. I hope you're doing some of these things, and if not, maybe you can start doing them this week. And Lent is a time not to just do the same old thing you always do. Make the next few weeks before Easter something special. Jesus says in Mark 8:34, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves, take up the cross, and follow me." Like you, I have a friend who worries about everything. Worry and fear drive her life. In fact, at times she tells me, if I don't have something to worry about, I worry until I have something to worry about. That may seem strange to some of us who are more relaxed, but if we were really honest right now, we too may also admit that we also have had times when we worried and really didn't need to. Times when things were going so well that we just knew something bad was going to happen. But why not turn that around? Why not reverse that kind of negative thinking or attitude? When things are going bad, why not think, you know, any minute now, things are going to get better because Jesus loves me. Or, to put it another way, Jesus will lead me from darkness to light. Because Jesus loves us, he wants to become our Lord and Master. And when that happens, Jesus leads us from the pew to the mission field. He leads us from stagnation to imagination. Jesus will lead us from loneliness to community. Jesus will lead us from worry to peace. The Bible says that peace that surpasses all understanding. Jesus will lead us from weakness to strength. He will lead us from serving only ourselves to serving many others. Jesus will lead us from death to life in this world and in eternal life, the next world. Today I would invite you to be inspired by some of the faith heroes in your life or in the Bible. Let their strength and unselfishness and joy put more energy into each of your steps. This is our time while we're living now. This is our church. This is our opportunity to turn away from sin, selfishness, and any problem and firmly embrace Christ and his love and mission opportunities. Real faith, hope, and love can be ours today. God will provide these things. The good Lord is busy right now calling and raising up in our own day people like Abraham, Sarah, Paul, Hazel Setzer, and you who are inspired by God's Spirit, whose voice will give strength to the church and whose witness will show the reality and power of Christ's kingdom. People often these days talk about the decline of the church, but I believe the decline of the church is now over. A new age of mission and growth has now begun. Jesus, not me, says the harvest is plentiful. It's just the laborers who are few. He says this in John 10, verse 2. Don't you want to see what the plentiful harvest will look like in your family, in your congregation, in your community, in your church? Don't you want to be on Christ's team? We thank God for all the positive examples he has provided us, past and present. But now this is our time. It's our turn. It's time for each one of us, no matter who we are, or how old we are, or what problems we have. It's time for each one of us to take up our cross and follow Jesus Christ. Each person can do something. We can pray. We can sing. We can worship. We can visit someone in a nursing home. We can invite. We can inspire others the way Jesus Christ inspires us and loves us. Friends, may nothing deter us from this vital mission, because only Christ and the church can give the world everlasting life. Amen. Our next song is one of my favorites. I hope it is for you too. You, Lord, Raise Me Up.
down. Oh, my soul so weary. When troubles come, my heart burden be. Then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. When evil comes, all my eyes are teary. When bad things rise, my soul hurting be. Then I am thrilled, your word shines in the darkness. Your spirit lives, it gives your light to me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up, Lord, to more than I can be.
Please pray the Lord's Prayer with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our final song is based on John 3:16. God loved the world. Please sing it with me, won't you? Partnership I have with you means a lot to me. I hope you have a very positive week and your Lent is meaningful. Now go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.